West Chester is located on high ground between two watersheds, both of which lead to the Delaware River. Before Europeans arrived, nobody really thought that was a very good place to live, but it was on the main trail between the Susquehanna Valley and the Delaware Valley, so Native Americans came through the area on a regular basis. When the first Europeans started to create settlements in the area, they settled down near the water along the Delaware River, and Philadelphia fairly rapidly became the main town in the region. It also became the capital for a colony founded by William Penn and developed by his sons, who envisioned it as some sort of social experiment whereby, instead of being totally loyal to a king, the people who lived there would be able to govern them themselves. With that in mind, they laid out a network of counties with administrative county seats that spread outwards from Philadelphia. Westchester was not one of the original ones, but after Delaware County became too big to manage, farmers found it too difficult to get to the county seat and get back again in the same day, it was divided in half, and Chester County became the western part, and Delaware County became the eastern part. Westchester became the county seat for that Chester County. The original town consisted of four squares laid out around the intersection of Gay and High Street. Through the 1820s, it stayed pretty much that way, with a few large farms completely surrounding it. But in 1827, a gentleman named William S. Everhart purchased the Woolerton Farm in the southwest part of town and divided it up into building plots. Amazingly, at least to everybody who was alive at the time, they sold quickly, and he also became the richest man in Westchester in the space of about 2 weeks. One of the things that probably helped with that was the introduction of the first railroad to the area, originally planned by businessmen out of Philadelphia who feared the loss of Western Pennsylvania trade to people living down in Baltimore. It did not pass through Westchester, but it came close enough for some of the wealthy farmers and the early businessmen in Westchester to decide to finance their own connection. So a short 7-mile line was laid from Westchester up to the main line that came out from Philadelphia, and that totally changed the way Westchester's economy worked. One of the things that it made possible was for farmers in Westchester to go into Philadelphia to sell their product, and for shop owners in Westchester to go bring things out from Philadelphia to sell to the farmers. As a consequence, the Westchester economy started to develop very rapidly in the 1830s, and even survived the Big Depression of 1837. Through the period leading up to the Civil War, Westchester was a center for an agricultural economy and the outlet to the rest of the world through the railroad line that led to Philadelphia. The amount of wealth generated by all this was enough to go and finance the construction of additional businesses and a number of schools that even reached all the way down to the southern states to go find pupils. Westchester became the administrative center for the entire county, and there was a steady stream of people from the far reaches of the county who came there to go and sell their goods, buy things that came from Philadelphia, register their deeds, get themselves married, and perform whatever other functions that could be performed by local government. The Civil War actually bypassed Westchester for the most part, and that's probably good news because it meant there was no destruction here. There was a camp where soldiers reported for duty, located on what is now the university property. And there were a number of parades and a couple of units raised by local leaders that used Chester County men to go off and fight in the war. So folks in Westchester were very aware of the war and, for the most part, basically benefited from it. After the war, some of the businesses that developed to go supply goods for the war, like, for example, a couple of brothers that started to manufacture wagon wheel spokes, kept going and using that railroad connection to both bring in raw materials and also to go and reach markets farther afield, created the first industries in Westchester. One of the common denominators of the first Westchester industries was that they all served agricultural customers in some way, either by providing wagon wheels or marketing trees and plants farther afield, and ultimately by producing products that would go and process dairy products, for example. The Sharpless Separator Works comes to mind. Westchester's industries grew quite rapidly and were very successful, even going on to win prizes in international competitions for things like wagon wheels that were sold as far away as South Africa. That success meant that the owners were able to expand, and in order to do this well, they needed to obtain labor. So a building boom followed that produced a lot of the housing that you find on the east side of town, what was described at the time as working class housing, that accommodated migrants who came in from farms in Chester County. There was some direct migration to Westchester from overseas, but most of it involved people who had already come to the area to work in the agricultural industries and then moved into town to go find jobs there. Economic development in Westchester was so successful that by the turn of the century, there were four major industries: the Hoops Brothers and Darlington Wheelworks, the Hoops Brothers and Thomas Nursery, the Sharpless Separator Works, and the Schramm Small Engine Company, which eventually became best known for the manufacture of portable air compressors. That economic success showed up in other ways as well. In 1871, the predecessor to Westchester University opened as a private school funded by local investors. After that, other industries that developed across the country also came to Westchester, so that by the time you get to the end of World War I, Westchester had four movie theaters, had several schools of higher education, a number of banks, insurance companies, real estate offices, and all of the other services that the 20th century Americans expected to find in their town, in their county seat. For lots of people in Chester County, Westchester was also the entertainment capital. Besides the movie theaters, Westchester also hosted one of a number of baseball teams that entertained people all over the county, and the F&M building, which was the tallest building in the town, and actually at one point the tallest building between Philadelphia and Lancaster, was also the site of a number of different thrills, like people climbing up the outside while their partners passed the hat amongst the admiring crowd. Folks flew balloons over Westchester, circuses came and performed there every year, and as a result, people from outside of town would come in on a Friday night or a Saturday night to see what was going on in Westchester, and there was usually something to do. 1920s also brought a big change to town in the form of motor vehicles. There's a story about somebody sitting on Gay Street in 1919 and counting the number of horses that went by and the number of cars that went by. And already by 1919, the numbers were about even. Clearly, the number of horses dropped off dramatically after that. And so it wasn't too long after that that people started to talk about parking, talk about making streets one way, and trying to go and manage the new transportation problems. Through the 1920s and 1930s, Westchester did quite well. And when the national economy suffered through the Great Depression, folks in Westchester certainly experienced its effects, but to a lesser degree, thanks to the diversified economy that was here. So as Westchester developed, people came here from all over the place. The first wave of immigration was naturally English Quakers and a few Germans, but the biggest wave in the 19th century was Irish. Both rural and urban Irish who left at different times. By the end of the century, the first people from Italy started to show up, and that wave of immigration swelled as a result of World War I. Subsequent to that, there's been people from all over the Americas, several waves of Hispanic immigration, and nowadays the most recent immigrants seem to be coming from Eastern Europe and from Africa. But Westchester is close enough to the Atlantic coast to be a destination for people arriving at least from the east, and had a diverse enough economy to be able to offer opportunity to a wide variety of people. From its origins as a center for education in the 19th century, and the investment by local movers and shakers in the predecessor of Westchester University, it was logical that Westchester would develop into a university town, as it is today. Westchester University was originally a model school intended to go and instruct people on how to teach, and it was constructed on a hill located south of town, which ended at Union Street back in 1871. By the 1920s, it had been taken over by the state of Pennsylvania, But its enrollment still remained relatively stable at between 1,000 and 2,000 students. It wasn't until after World War II, with the introduction of the GI Bill, that a large number of people started to go to the university for the first time. And in the 1960s, the size of the university expanded from 2,000 to 9,000, and then continued to expand beyond that to its current 18,000 students. Westchester also offered an excellent assortment of medical facilities for its inhabitants and the people in the surrounding county. Besides two hospitals located at the north end of town, there were doctors, dentists, and specialists who had offices in town as well. The Chester County Hospital, which still exists today, benefited from a donation from a wealthy family who helped them to move to their current site and construct the first rather monumental building that became the center for the most modern hospital in the entire Chester County. By the end of World War II, all of the things that had made Westchester a success were still in place, but America itself had changed as a result of the war. The introduction of the automobile, a new generation with access to education through the GI Bill, and new families looking for housing led to dramatic changes in the buildings and development patterns here in Westchester. For example, the surviving industries all became too large to function within a tight urban environment, and so they looked for space outside of town in the neighboring townships. That freed up land for the development of new housing, like that found up in Mayfield, Maryland Avenue, and over at Ford Circle. And it also enabled the redevelopment of some of the older industrial sites into new kinds of housing, like the Sharpless Separator Works, which was turned into modern apartments. So all of those changes, the movement of industry, the construction of new housing, the immigration of new people, and the expansion of education, laid the groundwork for the creation of a new kind of Westchester in the 21st century.